much, Jacques, for the invitation to have me, and thank you all for coming. It's like Jacques said, it's a great reunion to be here. You know, I see a lot of old friends in the audience, and it's been too many years since I've been here, so thank you very much. So as Jacques was mentioning, I spent a lot of time kind of thinking about biological systems, but then also computer science techniques, and then also biotechnology, the advances that we've seen over the last 20 years or so. And what I thought I would talk about today is kind of give you an update on some of the latest techniques to study genomes, very, very completely, very, very accurately, and very comprehensively, something I'm going to call perfect genome sequencing. Before kind of diving into it, let me just give you another sort of 10,000-foot overview of the type of work we do. About half of the work we do today is in human genetics. We have major projects undergoing in human diseases. Previously, we've worked in autism spectrum disorders, bipolar disorders, other sort of psychiatric diseases. Recently, it's become more and more focused around different cancers, major projects in breast cancer, prostate cancer, and pancreatic cancer. About the other half of the time, we spend in agricultural genomics, and there, as sort of an analysis standpoint, it's a lot of the same questions, looking at how different mutations, different genotypes can arise to different phenotypes, and there the work has been in major crop species like rice, corn, wheat, tomato, and so forth. What I really bring to the table is a lot of expertise at sort of the informatics level. We know how to write software that can scale up to large data sets. We know how to get entire data center working together to conquer these very large data sets that are being generated. And then also spend a lot of time thinking about sort of new biotechnologies that can sort of be augmented, enhanced, combined to give us new insights into biological systems. Recently been very, very interested in both single cell and single molecule sequencing as a way to probe inside of individual cells to really unlock all the true complexity that's living there. So I moved here to Hopkins about 2 years ago, and I've effectively had to reboot my group. So there's a number of kind of new students, new postdocs, new analysts in the group. I'm very open to collaborations, and at this point now we have capacity to kind of take on a bunch of new projects. So I'm very interested to hear what everyone is working on. Maybe you can catch me at lunch or a break or whatnot if there are different things that you'd like to talk about further. So today I'll be focusing on the sort of question about perfect genome sequencing, and being very playful here, of course, depending on how you want to define perfect, either we have it today or maybe we'll never have it. So what I'm going to do is try to argue that this is something that we should be striving for, talk about what I think it means to be perfect, how we're going to achieve it, and then when we're going to achieve it. So let's start with why perfect. So many of you know this story very well. In fact, many of you probably know this story better than I do. But if you remember back to 2000, there was this great announcement about the completion of the Human Genome Sequencing Project. And at the time, Bill Clinton announced that, without a doubt, this is the most important, most wondrous map ever produced by humankind. And I think at some level, this is true, right? In 1,000 years, when they think back about this era, I think one of the accomplishments that will be remembered was for the first time we were able to sequence a human genome. Just think about all of the amazing sort of insights that have been delivered from this. Starting with sort of basic things like being able to just know the sequences, know how many genes there are, be able to have a map of regulatory elements, and then sort of all the analysis that has been built on top of this. Everything we know about disease genomics, about basic sort of levels of regulation and transcription, comparative genomics, looking at evolutionary studies. It has been this wondrous map that has been built. And I think many of you in this room know that it has, though as wondrous as it's been, it has sort of a very complicated history to how it was put together. And I'm going to argue that maybe it's time to think about moving beyond having a single reference genome and then moving into personalized genomes. So in particular, the genome that was announced then wasn't actually just one genome. It was sort of a pair of projects that were announced simultaneously. So on one side, we had the private efforts from Craig Venter at Celera that some of us were participating in. And then on the other side, we had the public efforts led by Francis Collins that were poised to help put together this wondrous map that was established at that time. Although, as you sort of reflect on it, I think many, by now it's an open secret that the efforts at Celera were largely Craig's own genome, and that could be useful for certain studies, but in other ways it can be very limiting in the types of analysis they can do. And I think some of you may know this history about the international effort, but I kind of want to reflect on that for a minute, talk about some of the origins of the reference genome that's available today. So really, it was sort of first discussed very early, as soon as we had the capacity to sequence DNA. Of course, people are interested to sequence the DNA of humans, but really kind of matured in the 90s to have a really concentrated effort. And in fact, there was actually an ad placed in a newspaper in Buffalo, New York, by Peter DeJong from the Roswell Park Cancer Center that was there, you know, just calling for anonymous volunteers to come to the cancer center, have their blood drawn. And specifically, you probably can't see it here, but specifically they said that they would record no personal information about you. This was very much part of the IRB approval, was that, you know, yes, you could donate some sample, but we didn't want to know anything about you. We didn't want to, like, know where you're from, know anything about your diseases. They did say, you know, you'd be excluded from this if you were exposed to chemotherapy, but that was the only sort of restriction that was given at the time. At the time, you know, I think that was sort of thought to be sufficient safeguards that, you know, this would be one genome sequence. You know, it was inconceivable, I think, in the year 1999 when this was put out, or 97 when this was put out. It was inconceivable about, you know, just how rapidly progress would be made to be able to, you know, learn more about this individual. Of course, though, there has been great progress, and there's been various reports about this original sample. And buried on like page 145 in the supplement of the Neanderthal genome paper, there's this great analysis about, you know, who really was this reference genome, who were these 20 volunteers that went in here. And it turns out, just sort of by a series of sort of happenstance coincidences, even though there were supposed to be 20 volunteers, the vast majority of the human genome came from one volunteer, RP11. And it turns out that this one volunteer is an African-American male that happened to be living in Buffalo, New York. For whatever reason, his libraries were very successful, and then that contributed very largely to the genome. The second most abundant person in the reference genome is a East Asian, and then the next several are Europeans from that were just happened to be living around Buffalo. So that was kind of the original genome put together in around 2000. And then over time, though, things have even gotten a little bit weirder, which is that in an effort to make this a more universal reference, they've been the sort of consortiums that maintain the human reference genome have been systematically changing some of the variants that are there to go from, you know, rare variants, private variants in these individuals into sort of more common alleles. You can argue, is this a good thing, is this a bad thing, but it's just sort of, you know, it just takes what started out as being a mixture of many people and then sort of even stresses it even further. And then most recently, beyond just sort of flipping small alleles, they've been introducing the so-called alternate loci, where a few hundred regions where there's been noted that there's a lot of sort of variability in population, instead of just getting sort of different SNPs, you'll get even, you know, entire megabases, very large chunks, where you can say, well, it could be this version, it could be that version, you know, depending on who we're looking at. So the state of the art in the human genome, reference genome, and also the reference genomes of many other species, is something like this, where it's really a patchwork of many people putting, you know, contributing parts of their sequence, and it all gets sort of stitched together. And then, you know, it's been incredibly wondrous and it has been incredibly powerful, but it does introduce a number of really substantial biases. Some of these are quite, you know, kind of technical, nuanced, something called reference bias. As you go to map against this reference sequence, because it has a particular set of alleles there, that'll sort of bias the way the results will come out at the level of the genome, the transcriptome, the epigenome, and it can just really sort of distort the true view that is there. Furthermore, as a lot of the studies that are going on now are just missing a lot of the true variations that are present, so I think now is really a great time to think about, well, is there some way we can maybe move away from this patchwork and to think about, well, how can we have really detailed, you know, perfect personal genomes described? So why perfect? It's because it's very important from all the studies that can take place. It's very complicated about trying to get this comprehensive view, and it's very personal. Everyone's genome obviously is different. So what does it mean to be perfect? So there's many different metrics that you might consider for this, and sort of the first one that you might consider is something about, like, maybe correctness. So this will be how faithfully is the sequence of nucleotides match the sample that you're trying to measure. So to give, you know, I think people here, I'm sure, are very familiar with, say, Illumina sequencing, where you can get, you know, pretty good resolution. And I'm going to argue, though, that even though some of the new long-read sequencing technologies at some level produces what starts out as, you know, maybe a poor representation of the genome, you know, thanks to great innovations in the software level, we can advance upon this. So what I have here is an alignment of a real PacBio sequencing read aligned to the reference genome. And it's just sort of filled with all kinds of differences, even though this was a very controlled sample that we were processing here. This was from a yeast sample. This is a control. So this is kind of the results from PacBio biosequencing, where the dominant error model is a high enrichment for phantom insertions, where extra bases are picked up. Ironically, if you look at, say, today, Oxford nanopore sequencing, the alignment would be almost exactly the same, although it would be reversed who's the reference and who's the read, and that's because the dominant error model there is all deletions. So today, you know, there's these new technologies that produce very interesting data, but they have certain challenges associated with them. The good news is as we're gonna go, you know, try to put together genomes, either de novo or with respect to some reference, we're not just gonna look at one read at a time, we're gonna oversample the genome so that we can get a more faithful representation. So in particular, as we kind of do, say, reference-guided alignments, you know, we're trying to identify variants. You know, rarely would we trust the results from a single read. We want, you know, a whole stack of reads to support the genotype call that we're going to have here. And, you know, so if there were no sequencing errors, this would be an easy problem. But amazingly, even if there is sequencing errors, even if there is quite a lot of error present, with enough coverage, we can drive this error rate down as low as you might want to go. So this is analysis that we published a few years ago from both simulated data and then also trying to measure it in real data, where we can start out with, say, 16-17% sequencing error from, say, PacBio sequencing. And then with enough coverage shown on the x-axis, we can drive this error rate, you know, ever increasingly closer to zero, just because it's very unlikely to have the same mistake at the same position over and over again. The one sort of major caveat here is that this assumes that the errors are sort of randomly distributed, and that is largely true for PacBio sequencing. For the Oxford nanopore sequencing, there are random mistakes, but there are also certain systematic errors. And of course, there, even if you had infinite coverage, if you have a systematic error, you're going to have systematic defects in your sample. But nevertheless, so that was in 2012. Nevertheless, as we've moved into kind of more recent approaches, this is kind of one of the major sort of results from the Falcon paper that we worked on last year, was that not only can we assemble genomes de novo and get, you know, very nice contigs, very very complete representations of the genome, the accuracy there can be quite high. So using just PacBio sequencing, we can have an accuracy rate of about 99.99 overall. And then if you sort of, what we noticed was most of the residual errors were sort of localized into homopolymer sequences. If you exclude those, then the accuracy is something like 99.999% accurate. So just, you know, tiny amounts of residual error that remain. So, you know, I think this is just a testament to how having, kind of new and innovative biotechnology that maybe at first glance may look a little limited, sort of with the right software, with the right algorithms, we can address some of those deficiencies. So if correctness is sort of the first metric that you might care about, the second metric is probably something like completeness. And a lot of that is driven around sort of observations like this. So this is a map of all known GWAS hits distributed across the human genome. And this includes, you know, different disease phenotypes, drug responses, you know, basic traits. And kind of the key thing I want to highlight is that they're distributed everywhere. You know, it's not like they're highly localized, you know, important traits are only on certain chromosomes or certain chromosome regions. Basically, every position in the genome, in principle, can contribute to some sort of phenotype, if only we can go look for it. More specifically, back in 2012, ENCODE noted that something like 88% of all these GWAS SNPs were in intronic or intergenic sequences. So as powerful as exome sequencing has been to capture sort of protein coding variants, I think there's a lot of importance to look beyond the protein coding region, look in the whole genome. In my own lab, we've done some work looking at, say, non-coding mutations, and in particular in pancreatic cancer. And there, what we came to realize is that these non-coding mutations can be just as important to the cancer as any other coding mutation that can be commonly present there. So as good as we are at finding, say, SNPs and maybe small indels, I think kind of the last sort of frontier for studying human genomes in particular, and also the genomes of many other species, are studying these more complicated types of variants, particularly structural variants. So the canonical definition of a structural variant will be any sort of mutation, any sort of change to the sequence that's 50 base pairs or larger. Now, is there anything really special about 50 base pairs versus 49 versus 51? Not so much, but that's just sort of a useful working definition of a structural variation. So this could be things like deletions, this could be things like the insertion of novel sequences or mobile elements, this could be various rearrangements of translocations, other sorts of duplications, inversions, any sort of phenomenon you could imagine where there's some sort of large mutation to the genome. Now, I've become very, very interested in these types of mutations because they can have, you know, very profound impact on the structure and function of genomes. You can just imagine, you know, in the extreme, if you had an entire chromosome that was deleted or amplified, well, of course, that is going to have very significant changes to the phenotypes that you might be interested in. And then even more localized phenomenon, you know, kilobases, even maybe hundreds of base pairs can also have very pronounced effects. From this same review paper, there's a nice sort of map of all the ways that you might be able to characterize structural variations using different sequencing technologies. And they kind of break it up into, you know, basically it's asking the question is, you know, how you know, as you take reads and either you look at them de novo or you map them to a reference genome, you know, how well does the sequencing data match up to the reference that you're looking at? And kind of the key takeaway from this is for all the different things you might be interested in, so looking at sort of the pair position, the depth of coverage, you know, maybe having split read alignments or maybe de novo assemblies, the key thing, the key innovation that we can notice that's universal across all these approaches is that it gets better as your sequencing data gets longer. And today there are two major platforms for long read sequencing. There's the PacBio instrumentation today, the PacBio SQL, and then also the Oxford Nanopore technology. Today that includes the Minion, and then also the Gridion, and you know, someday maybe the Promethean. So on the left there is a picture of the SQL. That's with my little son James at the release party here in Baltimore a couple years ago. I teased my wife that I was going to put him inside the instrument, but she said, absolutely not, can't do that. That's as good as you get. But with the Minion, that's become one of his favorite toys, you know, a $1,000 sequencer he likes to play with all the time. So some of the advantages of these platforms, so you know, because it's single molecule, there are no amplification artifacts because there's no amplification that has taken place. And then because of the very long reads, we get sort of, you know, much improved mapping, we get much improved de novo assemblies, and we're just going to be able to sort of access all parts of the genome, even if they are inaccessible using short read sequencing. So it's been really powerful in that regard, and then in particular for structural variations, this is definitely our preferred platform for being able to resolve them. The big challenge, of course, is that if you're trying to find structural variations, say, using a mapping approach, is if you've ever looked at the alignment of these data to the reference genome, it might look like this. So this is a picture of real PacBio sequencing reads in a human sample aligned with BWMM. We think, based on sort of coverage and other signals, that there might be a deletion there, but you get this sort of very complicated alignment where you get these regions where you're just not really sure of what's going on there. In the last couple years, though, we've been studying these alignments, and we've come to realize that you can actually get really good signals about the structural variations that are present if only you have the right aligner. So here's a picture of these same reads, the same locus aligned using our new aligner that we call NGMLR, very clearly being able to, you know, identify where this deletion is taking place. This is a great improvement for deletions. We see kind of the same phenomenon if there's an insertion, inversion, translocation. You know, now that we have the right aligner, that we can really go in and study these in great detail. I should highlight that this work really comes from my former postdoc, Fritz, and then a former student of mine, Philip, that have really put in all the hard work to solve this. So in addition to getting, you know, now we can get, you know, really detailed maps of all the structural variants that are present in the genome. And today, in every sort of human sample that we look at, we're seeing on the order of 20,000, maybe 30,000 structural variations that are present, the vast majority of which have been missed using alternative technologies. So in addition to getting sort of more complete and just more accurate view, you know, one thing that we've been able to really resolve is if you've ever run a structural variation pipeline using short read data, especially in, say, a human genome, you often get like many thousands of these translocation calls, even in what you believe to be a healthy sample. It's always been sort of very unsettling for me, is like, where are all these translocations coming from? So here's just one example of many thousands that we've looked at, where, you know, from the Illumina data, we'll have, you know, what looks like pretty good alignments, where you'll have, you know, in particular from the missing pairs, they're all saying, yep, there ought to be some other sequence that is present here, but it's all jumping to some other chromosome. So that would be your signal for the translocation call. But then thanks to, you know, long read sequencing, when we look in the same sort of locus, what we see is that it's not a translocation, but instead it's a small insertion in this example, about 50 base pairs, that is present there. So not only do we get sort of, you know, improved accuracy, it's been a huge relief to me that, you know, no, there are not thousands and thousands of translocations in human genomes. It's just that you get these systematic mapping artifacts when you're using short read data that just sort of confuse the analysis systems. But then, given long reads, we can go right through those longer insertions and be able to resolve the true variants that are present there. So it developed as a research project in my lab, and now it's starting to be applied in a number of different cases. This is actually not our own work, although they use early versions of the software where they're trying to find structural variations associated with particular Mendelian disease. And in this example, from researchers at Stanford University, we're trying to understand, you know, what was the genetic cause behind a heart defect that had been, they had tried probing it using Illumina sequencing of various forms. They tried probing for this for the genetic defect in, you know, many different technologies. And it turns out here, just using low coverage PacBio sequencing with our aligner, they could recognize, oh yeah, there was this big deletion in this critical gene that had previously been unrecognized, and they've been able to further classify this as being the causal pathogenic variant. So we're, you know, we're very proud of this result. We're now, you know, thanks to newer biotechnologies and newer software, we can finally, you know, resolve the true complexity of these more complicated Mendelian diseases. In my own lab, we've also applied this to a variety of cancer samples. So this is some results from a recent preprint we have describing the results in a breast cancer cell line where we're trying to characterize the true complexity. And sort of the same sort of story holds true. We're able to identify you know, many translocations that have previously been unrecognized. Here, this is a cancer sample, so, you know, the translocations are expected. In fact, the vast majority of which validate in the lab. And then even, you know, beyond those huge events, as we drill down into the structural variations, 50 base pairs or larger, we're seeing, you know, many times more variance with the long read data compared to the short read data. So I think, you know, two of the most important metrics that we think about are going to be this correctness and this completeness. And there, I'm going to argue, it's going to be, you know, the kind of the right combinations of the right biotechnologies and the right software algorithms to get there. So how specifically are we going to achieve this? Well, today there's a whole number of technologies that are available, you know, just at the bench. Everything from, you know, improvements to sample preparation, high throughput sequencing, various chromosome mapping technologies. And so that, I think that's a great opportunity for us if we can just sort of find, you know, the right combinations that'll get us the right results that we can. Most directly, we have a recent project where we've been sequencing some primary tissue from samples, and then also functional data of many different forms. But in terms of the genomic sequencing that is available, here we have Illumina, 10x Genomics, PacBio, also Hi-C data that I'll talk about in a minute. And kind of, you know, we have kind of, you know, this is sort of state-of-the-art sequencing data for these different platforms. And kind of, you know, as we do the analysis, so here we're doing de novo assemblies of these different data types. You know, kind of the first observation is you get, you know, whereas maybe you'll get, you know, fairly small contigs with Illumina sequencing, they get somewhat improved using the linked read sequencing, but then they get massively improved using the long read sequencing. And then as we scan those contigs relative to the reference to look for structural variations, there's a number of sort of important features that come out here. So here I have insertions, deletions, repeat expansions, repeat contractions, tandem expansions, tandem contractions identified out of the de novo assemblies compared to the reference. So one of the first observations is that using the long read data, we can observe, you know, many, many more insertions than you can find using the other technologies. And notably, the insertions that we see are well mirrored by the deletions that we also see. Here, these, as you kind of zoom into them, we note that these are all ALU insertions and deletions that are there. So that kind of makes sense that those would be, you know, jumping around a lot in the genome. In contrast, if you look at other sorts of variants, will be, say, tandem expansions that can be picked up using long reads that are missed by the other technologies. In contrast, if you look at, say, the 10x Genomics, not only is it missing the insertions that we're really interested in, you get these like weird patterns of all these deletions that don't really make any sense. And when if you can pin down the developers, at this point, they've admitted that there are some systematic sort of defects in the software and also the library preparation. So I caution you, if you're working with new biotechnologies, you know, you could have these sort of phantom artifacts lurking in your data that you may need to address. So we've done careful studies, comparing these different data types using different pipelines, and kind of the punchline from all of this is we're getting, you know, by far the most variance using PacBio sequencing, and also giving kind of the best concordance if you're using different strategies to look at it. So the missing attributes to all of this, though, is now we know where all these variants are, and now we want to create personalized genomes from them. The last piece of this is we want to be able to phase them to actually be able to separate out the maternal and paternal haplotypes. So if there are no sequencing error in the data, this would be a relatively straightforward approach. You know, you would just look through the patterns of, say, SNPs or other variants in your data, and then you would sort of just partition it, try to find some place where you could split up the reads that were similar to each other. In real data, it's not so simple here because there's sequencing error that sort of don't always allow for clean breaks. But there are some nice algorithms that can try to resolve this problem. For the computer scientists in the room, though, this problem is NP-hard to solve exactly. So it's a lot of different heuristics are used to try to address this. At the end of the day, if you want good phasing, it's all about read length, right? Because here we have this unphased block in the middle. But if our reads had been longer, they would have been able to connect the phase block one with the phase block two. And so this was from a study we did, with very idealized data of different lengths. You know, how successful could you be with the phasing? And kind of the punchline from this is with short reads, you get very limited phasing. As you get to longer reads, you get better. And it just gets increasingly better as you go to longer and longer read lengths. Or in the case of HiSeq, you get these really long, you can think of them as like mate pairs that are really, really successful for doing long range phasing. So now we have ways to sort of take this data where we can do phasing, say using different combinations of data. Maybe use the 10x data and the HiSeq data to phase all the SNPs in the genome, and then we can project all those SNPs into the PacBio reads so that we can do localized phasing of the structural variations that are present. And then the last piece of the puzzle is now that we have all these phase variants, we have these phased haplotypes, we can then go in and then insert them into the reference genome. So we'll get as close to perfect as we can possibly get to give you a perfect phase diploid genome assembly. So how are we going to achieve this? Well, I'm going to argue it's going to be through this combination of having very long reads and long mates. The combination that I would recommend today would be probably PacBio or Oxford Nanopore, depending on your costs. And then augmented that with probably HiSeq data if you want to get true chromosome results associated with that. So when are we going to be able to do this in a routine way? Well, if you look at this chart that we have here, one view of this would be, well, we can do it today in the sense that we can drive the accuracy of the results to be arbitrarily as good as we want just by doing deeper and deeper sequencing. The more pessimistic view of this is we're never going to get truly perfect genome sequencing because we can drive it to fractions of a percent, but you never actually get to 0% accuracy. So really, this question about when can we have perfect genome sequencing, when can we characterize all the variants that are present there, in some level is a question about how much funding do we have available. And the good news is that the costs for long read sequencing have been dropping quite dramatically over the last few years. So the first instrumentations we're talking about many thousands of dollars per gigabase of sequencing, and now it's dropping into $1,000 or maybe even just a few hundred dollars per gigabase. There's some new technologies on the horizon from Oxford Nanopore. There's a new instrument called the Promethean that in theory will be available sometime in the future. No one's quite sure about when that'll happen. That could drive down the cost further. And then also on the SQL, on the PacBio line, they've been talking about massively increasing the throughput on the SQL that should also hopefully drive down the cost. But today, we're talking about a few hundred dollars per gigabase is about the best you can do using current technology. In my group, we have projects underway where we're going to apply these technologies to a number of different samples. So we have healthy human genomes, we have cancerous human genomes, we have projects underway in corn, we have projects underway in tomato. And the idea is, now that we can get more or less these perfect genome sequences, we can then use that to overlay all kinds of functional data to look at really accurately, really completely, how do all these variants interplay expression and regulation. So just to sum up, we should all strive for perfection, and I think kind of the two major metrics here are going to be striving for 100% correctness, 100% completeness. I think the key today to do that will be to look for combinations of technologies, in particular those long read sequences is incredibly important in order to be able to find all the structural variation. And I think from all this we're going to have really detailed understanding of the causes of different diseases, the forces of evolution, and other studies. Today, if you want to have sort of the absolute best results, I recommend this combination of probably long read sequencing with HiSeq data to give you the best resolution of all the structural variants, all the small variants, and also be able to phase them. What are we going to learn from this? Well, we're finding tens of thousands of variants that were previously missed, and that contributes many megabases of variation that has never been seen before. Things I'm interested to do now is now that we have relatively easy, say, diploid genome sequences figured out, extend this into higher ploidy. That's very important for certain plant species and also very important for, say, cancer. And then also push this into the single cell level where we can look at, one cell at a time, all the amazing variation that is present. So there's lots of people in my group that I need to thank for all this work. You know, the funding has been diverse, but never generous enough. But that's really what I'm here today, is to try to talk to all of you to hear about what sort of projects you're working on to try to find places for new collaborations. So with that, I'll go ahead and I'll just thank you, and I'll be happy to take any questions. Thanks, everybody.